the attack on thought and ideas in our media, it is ignorance why we don't understand. I mean, it's, you know, if there's no Jewish state, you know, and Israel's not there, there's lots of places where Jews can go and rule themselves. Like, you know, you've got the country of, well, then there's the country of, oh, wait, there's just Israel. There's none other. The only place where Jews can actually be themselves and rule themselves from a homeland of 4,000 years ago, promised to them by God, it's just Israel. There's not another one. There's nowhere else. If you're a Muslim, where can you live? And rule yourself. Well, most Muslim countries don't rule themselves because it's usually a dictatorship somewhere involved. But let's be real. From the river to the sea, do you even know what river? And do you know what sea? Because most of them don't. It's just sheer ignorance. It's ignorance. And our children in colleges are being duped. And because a professor says it, it's true. It's not true. This course will help you understand. And it's not indoctrination. In fact, just the opposite. It just lays out historical facts you can look up. And it starts from the very beginning. It takes it from a political view. It takes it from a religious view. You can look at it from whatever direction you want, and this course will help you. So I'm not trying to sell a course. Mainly, I would encourage you to tell your pastor, start a small group in your church. I believe everything should be done through churches. I'm not big on groups that are beyond that. I think it all ought to have accountability through churches. And so don't go off rogue on your own. I mean, you can, I guess, whatever. Go to your pastor and be submitted and say, hey, is this good for our family? And if he says, we don't need it, maybe maybe you ought to think twice, or he needs to take the course. Say, would you take the course so I can still be in your church? And that may not be such a bad thing. Here's the thing, though. It's easy to teach. Anyone in this room can teach it because you're learning as you go. That simple. It's easy to teach. All right. I'm not going to push this off any longer. In fact, I'm very excited. I'm going to ask Lynn to come and our guest. Lynn's going to introduce him. Lynn Jacobson. Does anyone know Lynn? Yeah? All right. She's a woman of God and has just so thankful for her in our community. And so I'm going to be real shameless here. I didn't get a selfie with any of them. And if you guys ever see my Facebook, I got to have that. So we'll act like you're not here. Everyone, close your eyes. Look at there. I got it. So anyway, let's welcome them. And I appreciate Lynn as she introduces our guest.
Thank you so much, Pastor Aaron. We're so excited for Pastor Aaron and what he's done in his church family. So let's give him a clap and his wife, and it's really amazing. And these pictures really tell stories of real people. It's really interesting around Thanksgiving, so October 7th to November, right before Thanksgiving, one of the organizations said, take one of these names and invite them to your Thanksgiving table. And they had a little table tent so you could have. And I chose a young boy named Ohad Munder. And he was one of the first ones released. He was at our Thanksgiving table. We all prayed for him before we ate a bite of food. And then to see him released, my whole family, whether they're supportive of Israel or not, when we found out that he was released, everybody rejoiced and then cried. You know, they were like touched. And so if you take, Pastor Aaron has so much gigas and stuff for you to take. It's amazing. But take one of these. It says Israel. You can take, I just already put it on my coffee mug. Or if you wear a pin, people are going to ask you, what's that pin? What's this bracelet? What is this? And so Pastor Aaron gave us some of the why today. And so our friend Daniel Carlson is going to give you some of the what and how to respond, like, why are you supporting Israel, who's just killing all these poor Palestinians? What's the point? Why don't we just have a ceasefire? So listen carefully. He's going to share his heart. He is the humanitarian director for CBN, Christian Broadcasting Network, in Israel. It's a huge job, and he serves all the people in Israel. And he's going to share from his heart some of the things that they do. He'll be sharing some stories, but some of the what and the why and the how as you respond, because you're going to get these questions. And you might have questions in your own heart. So I encourage you to listen carefully. And as he shares and just opens the word, and you're going to see that there's different kingdoms. There's the kingdom of light, the kingdom of darkness. And we are people that are a kingdom of light. And so it's going to take us to take that light into our own communities and friendships as we have conversations. So Daniel, thank you so much for coming all the way from Israel. All right.
Thank you, Lynn. Let's see. Well, it's a real pleasure to be with you. Pastor Aaron, thank you so much for your hospitality. Breakfast was great. When I get out of Israel, I actually do like to indulge in additional bacon. Look, it's available, you know. In Israel, it's a little harder to come by. And I love bacon. I think it'll be part of the marriage supper of the Lamb, personally. I know, theologically, let's not part ways over it, but... as we were doing the little praise and worship session, you know what's good about praise and worship is you're entering into his gates, right, with thanksgiving and praise. And when we sing, and we sing songs that, you know, okay, we hear these things over and over, and so we know the words, and we can sing along. And what that does is we go through our ups and downs. You know, we have good days, bad days, we have struggles, we have darkness, we have, you know. And no matter what day it is, when you enter into his courts, those words and those songs, it points your mind, your spirit, your consciousness into a certain direction, and in the direction of the kingdom. And so even if you're going through a dark time and you can't see beyond the clouds, the words in the music express something of a heart direction that sees beyond the clouds. Now for us in Israel, the last 4 months have been tremendously hard. There's a lot of grief. This is a tremendous storm for the people of Israel. And what it reminded me of is there's a prayer that Jewish people say over the grave of a loved one who's passed away or been killed or whatever. And of course, we've had a lot of funerals. This is the prayer that usually a son will say over his father and mother when they die. And it's a formal prayer. Now, I'm not big into formal, like most evangelicals, we wing it, right? You know, you don't have a prayer book that you read out of. You come before the Lord and you just express what's on your heart. But there is a thing to prayer, especially if you're praying over the deceased. In other words, usually you're in a time of grief. And time of grief is a time where it's easier to lose sight of God and of, you know, just the reality that's hidden from you right now, because you're in grief. So I wanted to read a translation of the Jewish prayer over the grave of a loved one. This is what you would say over a loved one if you were a Jewish person, and this has been said hundreds and hundreds of times in the last few months of whether it's a father over who just lost his son in the army, in the battle, or whether it's someone whose remains have been found and recovered and they're bringing them to burial. These are the words that are, you say it so often that it becomes memorized. And then the places where it says amen, everybody has said this prayer many times, so you already know where the amen is, and there's several amens along the way. And then all the people kind of say amen to it. So may the great name of God be exalted and sanctified throughout the world, which he has created according to his will. May his kingdom be established in our lifetime and in your days, and then the lifetime of the entire household of Israel, swiftly and in the near future, and say amen. May his great name be blessed forever and ever. Blessed, praised, glorified, exalted, extolled, honored, elevated, and lauded be the name of the Holy One. Blessed be he. Above all and beyond any blessing and hymn and praise and consolation which are uttered in the world, and say amen. May there be abundant peace from heaven and life upon us and upon all of Israel, and say amen. And he who makes peace in his high holy places, may he bring peace upon us and upon all Israel, and say amen. Even non-religious Jews, even non-secular, that's the prayer. And it's a prayer that redirects the heart. Somehow, the words uttered redirect the heart towards a God who is beyond the current grief. And that's a very special thing in the culture and fabric of a people, because it's always, that's where you go. And it covers over the separation of ideology and opinion and left and right and politics and this and that. Everybody meets in the same place beside a grave and declares, did you see how many times God is exalted in the prayer? The whole focus of the prayer is the exaltation of God. That's really an interesting thing when you think about what is a fabric that makes up a culture. Now, I was born and raised in Israel. My parents were evangelical Christians, and they moved to Israel towards the late 60s. They came from California, just felt a call of God on their lives to show love to the Jewish people. And that's not something that was too much, that wasn't real popular back then. All the attention towards Israel, like the church for many, many years, was stuck in a theology. It still exists today. It's officially called replacement theology, which basically says that the church has replaced Israel, and all the promises that were for the Jews are now for the church, and they are the branches that got cut off, and that's it. Now, when the Gentile church decided that it had taken the place of their older brother, we see in the history of the church that it brought great darkness. And I think spiritual blessing has to be a result of being in line with the values of God himself. And when we steer away from that because our own whatever, misconceptions, spiritual darkness or whatever, that we get out of alignment. Now, I don't know how many of you guys go to chiropractors. I used to go quite often when I worked in construction in the oil fields. And then, you know, you get out of alignment and things hurt. And then you go to the chiropractor and he cracks you around. And then all of a sudden things feel a lot better. Why? Because you've been adjusted back into, things are not now bumping up against each other. And so now the pain goes away. And sometimes the pain down here is a result of something right here. And it's the same thing spiritually. Sometimes spiritual darkness in your life is the result of misalignment of your understanding of who God is and what his value systems is. And you're living according to misguided, and it's affecting this over here. And you're trying to deal with this over here. When this remains out of alignment, you'll never deal with anything over here. It'll always hurt. And I think that's where the church was for many, many years. And just like Israel of old, we've missed it on the same scale. We really have. I mean, as a church body, I'm talking about the worldwide community of faith, we've just, doesn't mean people are not saved, it just means people are misaligned, misguided, and then they miss out on all the things that God would have brought in fulfillment in their lives. Why? Because they just didn't get it. Now, I think that when you look at Scripture, what's an example of this? When the Lord is with us, in Matthew 21, it talks about Jesus being questioned about his authority. He comes up to Jerusalem, and he's demonstrating authority and responsibility. And of course, he's not of the priesthood, and he's not of the Pharisees, and he's not of the Sadducees. He's not in leadership in the nation. And so they want to know, wait a minute. By what authority do you do these things? You guys remember the passage? It says, now, when he came into the temple and the chief priests and the elders of the people confronted him, he was teaching and said, by what authority do you do these things? And who gave you this authority? But Jesus answered and said to them, I will ask you one thing, which if you tell me, I will likewise tell you by which authority I do these things. The baptism of John, where was it from? From heaven or from men? Now they reasoned among themselves, and they said, if we say from heaven, he will say, why then did you not believe him? But if we say from men, we fear the multitude, for they all count John as a prophet. So they answered and said to Jesus, we do not know. And he said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. Now, I think in every generation and in your lifetime, the Lord does things that run against your way of doing things. And he comes in and he says, I'm the authority. I want to be the ruler. And this is how I'm doing things. And then, of course, our challenge since the fall in the garden. I mean, what does the apple represent? The apple represents you shall be like God. We want to be our own God. And so Jesus comes and he challenges our kingship over our lives. And then by what authority do you take and who gave you that authority? And then the Lord points at things that are current, that are really obvious. And he says, this over here, is it from heaven or from men? Now, if it conflicts with your theology, you may say, I don't know. Because you can't acknowledge, because then it would cause you to have to change your theology. And people's theology has become God in and of itself. And then the Lord walks away from you and leaves you in your darkness. That's the result. And the Pharisees have done it, and the church has done it. And I think the existence of the state of Israel, its actual existence, is something that is miraculous by any count. And it has a whole line of scriptures that are fulfilled in our day, in our lifetime. And God says, I have shown you that I'm at work. This is indeed miraculous, and it is my hand. Now, are you going to align with it, or are you going to say, we don't know? And I think when we say, you know what, because my theology is that God is done with the Jews and they have no place anymore, and now it's this, I can't accept that that's from God, and therefore I don't know. And God will withdraw from you and leave you in darkness. And I think that's the challenge of the age for us in the Gentile body of Christ in Israel. I think God is extending and he's saying, there is coming a time, and it is now, where you can no longer just sit on some fence of indifference, because this is what I'm doing in the earth. Now you think, well, I mean, we live in Oregon. What's the, like, why does this matter to me? What should I care about the Middle East and far away and all of that? I think, and I'll quote some statistics by Dr. Michael Brown, who, according to the study of some missiologists, those are people who study missions, historical trends and missions and numbers and statistics, he said that if, let's say, the world ended today and we were all the body of Christ, the body of believers, were in heaven in one room. From the time of Jesus all the way to present day today, that if we were all in one big room, 75% approximately of the people in the room would have accepted the Lord after 1948. In other words, 25% would have been from the first century all the way almost 2,000 years of history. And then 75% would have been people that accepted the Lord after the establishment of the State of Israel. And then, he said, of that 75%, 75% of them would have accepted the Lord after 1967. Now, personally, when I look at all the evidence, when I look at the prophetic outlay of Scripture, when I look at, I like looking at the life of Paul, because Paul was a Pharisee. And he was converted in a miraculous way. The Lord really turned his life around in a very unique way. And then he was very instrumental in the spread of the gospel to the Gentile, to us. And was very effective. And his strategy was everywhere he went first to the synagogue and shared with them. And when they rejected, he would go and open the door to the Gentiles. Now, we might want to learn from Paul's attitude, but I think in Romans it talks about Paul really expresses his heart for his own people who persecuted him greatly. Paul really suffered at the hands of the resisting Jewish people to the gospel. And he said of them, he said, I wish that I were cut off from Christ if it meant saving some of them. I'm willing that I would be cut off. I don't even deserve to be part of the kingdom. And I'd be willing even to be cut off so that some of them will become part of the kingdom. That was his heart for the Jewish people. Now, I think when you have a heart attitude that values what God values, the Lord shows you things that you wouldn't understand otherwise. And I think the image in Romans about the branches that were cut off and the branches that were grafted in, and we Gentile believers are wild olive branches that were grafted in to that root. He also talks about the regrafting in of those who were cut off. And that we're not at all to not make room for them, to not acknowledge that they are our common brothers and sisters. But I think he expresses something very unique that is overlooked. And when he talks about in Romans 11 about how now if they, talking about the Jewish people's rejection of the Messiah, he talks about because they rejected the Messiah, the door of salvation was opened up to you Gentiles. And he says, now if their rejection meant riches, spiritual riches for you, then he says, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? So he lays out, and I think this is a God principle, that the spiritual release of blessing to Israel releases spiritual blessing to us. I think that there's no doubt in my mind that the creation, the physical creation of the state of Israel, unleashed spiritual blessing on the church that created a move of God that was unprecedented in previous church history. Without relation, it's not like the Billy Graham crusade movement had a whole lot to do with the state of Israel. It wasn't like these are connected. Billy Graham didn't preach a lot about Israel. He just had a simple gospel message, but the impact, the multiple impact, and then after the Six-Day War, again, another huge boom with regards to, you have to say, well, are these two things related? If they are related, if for 2,000 years, as the church ignored Israel, persecuted Israel, was on the wrong side of this thing, if that's what led to a retardation of growth of the body of Christ because of our attitude towards Israel, and then all of a sudden, the existence of Israel, God bringing into existence Israel, and we see at the same time a huge change in spiritual dynamic in the body of Christ and in the church. Are those two things related? I believe they are. Now you may, I don't know, that's a little bit of a stretch. I don't know. Well, okay, so 48, there's this huge, and it's a huge change. That's an enormous change. And then in 1967, in the reunification of Israel, the reunification of Jerusalem, you have again this wave. Is there no relationship? I think that it would be hard not to look at that and say, you know, according to the way Scripture is, we might need to adjust our theology. Now, I think that the current, there's actual a lot now of people that are aware of this. God has brought the body of Christ together with the Jewish people in common cause. Like, we have a common, you know, it's not like we agree on everything, but it's not the point. It's almost like the brothers have found each other. And there's a working together. And also for us at CBN and the humanitarian projects that we do, our primary support is from evangelical Christian community in the United States. And there's a real understanding of we as the body of Christ have an obligation to stand with what we believe God is doing in Israel. That we are to show love and mercy to the Jewish people. And that the war against Israel is an actual part of the war, the spiritual war against our own faith. I don't think that, like, in military strategy, when you think militarily, if you want to know what is really important to your enemy, then you just focus on what they're going after the most. And I think the enemy, by his strategy, is showing us, the body of Christ, what is really important in the spiritual realm. Why is it? Have you guys heard that Azerbaijan has invaded Armenia? I mean, has anybody heard that? I mean, one, two. Why? I mean, that's a total invasion of a whole sovereign country. There's a lot bigger conflicts going on in the world than the conflict between Hamas and Israel. Why is Israel always the focus? Why in the United Nations, the only nation that seems to ever get condemned all the time consistently is always Israel? Dr. Peterson, Jordan Peterson, some of you know who I'm talking about? Very enjoy listening to him. He has very good stuff. But he was talking about Israel. He said, you know, Israel is the only, like, if you took this situation between Israel and the Palestinians, all the wars in the last 100 years, all of them, 100% of them, are between either two dictatorships or a dictatorship and a democracy, and it's always the dictatorship that attacks the democracy. If you're to believe the narrative that Israel is always at fault and all that, Israel would be the only exception in 100 years where a democracy attacks a dictatorship. What's the likelihood? What are the odds that worldwide, because, you know, basically war sucks. War just is a drag, and nobody likes it. And in a democracy, if you want to get elected out of office, then I'm not talking about necessary wars, because wars do happen and some of them are necessary. I'm talking about if all of a sudden Joe Biden decided to attack, I don't know what. I mean, it's hard to even come up with an example. And people would be like, yeah, I'm not on board with that. And then, so the person in charge in a democracy is worried about your opinion. In the long term, maybe not on the day to day, but in the long term, they're kind of worried about you not voting for them. So democracies tend to avoid war, whereas dictatorships, Your opinion doesn't matter to me. Because I don't need to go to you for approval. I'll do what's in the best interest of the country, and that's it. Is it logical that in 100 years of human warfare worldwide, Israel is the only democracy that instigates attacks against her Arab neighbors? And but the enemy is definitely showing us by it the obsession of the vilification of Israel on the world stage shows us what is important to him. And I think that Satan realizes more than we do that unlocking that key is the opening to a door that will lead to the destruction of his kingdom. So what is spiritually going on in Israel will either block or release spiritual blessings on Eugene, Oregon. I'm talking about in the realm of just the spirit. So if we as Christians believe that the heavenly kingdom is what's really at work here, and we want a viewpoint that says, hey, what is God doing in the earth? And then how do I plug in? So it's true, there's organizations like CUFI, like CBN Israel, like, you know, other organizations that like the Christian Embassy. It's an expression of the church's modern understanding that there is a connection between us and physical Israel, and that it's a good connection. One of my good friends in Israel, he's a lawyer, and he had the opportunity to go around with some of the family members of hostages, and they would go and do speaking in other places. And he took, do you guys remember, I don't know what you guys get in the news, because I know news here in general has kind of moved on from the story, because, you know, you have elections in November, and that's far more important. But for us, everything is about this, every day, all day. In Israel for 4 months, it's been October 7th for 4 months, every morning. It's another October 7th, and it's all about hostages, it's all about the stories. And so he had gone with them, and among other things, they went to Washington, D.C., and spoke to people on Capitol Hill, and then he took them also to some venues that was in front of evangelical Christians. I think they went to like Liberty University Virginia, right? Liberty. But they went to some of these venues and now when they came back, there was an incident in Gaza where there were three hostages who were being held together. Their captors were killed, and they had miraculously survived kind of going from house to house in Gaza on their own for like several days. And they were trying to signal the Israeli army that were hostages, were that, and they tried to surrender to them, and they were shot and killed, all three of them. So in the heart of the nation was just broken. I mean, here we had an opportunity to reclaim three lives. One of them was a Bedouin Arab young man, and then two other Israelis. Well, he had gone around with one of the guys that was killed in that incident, and it was their brothers. That this guy's brothers were the ones he went around with. And he went to the funeral, and then you go, you know what the Shiva is? Shiva is the Jewish traditional mourning period of 7 days where you sit down. It's called sitting Shiva. For 7 days, you mourn for the dead. And so he went to visit them, and the young men had come back after experiencing fellowship with evangelical Christians who support Israel, and they told their mom they want to be like the Christians. And so she said to him, you know, what did you do to my sons? But they found warm fellowship in our community as Gentile believers. And one of the things that during this war that I really emphasize in all the work that we do and the different aid projects and all that sort of thing, my ability to support and show love and distribute humanitarian aid and do different projects, everything is done in saying, I'm representing millions of Christian evangelicals who love the God of Israel and who love you and pray for you and stand with you and support you in a tangible way. And the perception in Israel very easily and very often is the whole world hates us. Really, the ability to kind of just feel completely isolated, and you see the protests on college campuses and all this other stuff, and violent protests, not, these aren't just run of the mill, these are, you know, where's a Jew we can lynch? I mean, that's how bad it is here, let alone Europe and places like that. And they come and they're among us and they feel a kinship and that they're not alone. And you don't understand how tremendous and how important your love and support for the people of Israel is to them. And that we're able to do projects and say, hey, I know these people. They really do stand with you. They do really in a heart-to-heart way. They support you. That is a tremendous message. Now, Paul, in quoting Moses, talks about the day that God will use a non-people to make them jealous, to make the children of Israel. And he said, because of your idolatry, because God compares his relationship to Israel like a marriage, and then all of a sudden idolatry is her affections go for someone else in place of her legitimate husband. And God's the husband. And he says, one day I'm going to take a non-nation and I'm going to make you jealous of my relationship with them. You're it. You're the non-nation. We're this group of misfits that God has chosen out from among the peoples and has poured out his love on us. And that causes a jealousy. Well, for much of the history of the church, we have not demonstrated a proper reflection of the love of God because we've been hostile to the Jewish people. And it's been a stain on our testimony as a body of Christ. It's a legitimate historical stain. But I'm grateful to say that we live in a time where the body of Christ, certain not small segments of the body of Christ, have woken up and said, this is what God is doing, and this is who we need to stand with. And they've actually it's like the body of Christ is starting to come around to that awareness, and you guys are part of that. And that is a, this is a unique time in history. And I really do believe that the conflict, the wars, it's an upheaval time in Israel, obviously, because of all this. But that the Lord is working through all this in order to bring to a release of something that we haven't seen. Because we all do believe that the world doesn't just go on in perpetuity until mankind destroys himself. We believe that the Prince of Peace one day is going to come and interrupt history and put an end to conflict and sorrow and wars. That's our hope. Our hope isn't to elect just the right group of people who can figure out how we can get along with each other. That's probably not going to work, because we're just people. So our faith in the Lord is that he's coming, he's doing, he's on his way, he's at work, and we want to get in line with that. Now, on a practical level for the community here in Oregon, I know that the body of Christ in the United States, just because there's a good number of us, we tend to kind of segment from each other, and I'm kind of doing my thing, and you're doing your thing, and then there's, you know, all that. But we need to learn to find common cause with each other, where it doesn't interrupt each other's calling and specific, you know, what you feel the Lord has really laid in front of your community or whatever. But Israel is something we can really find common cause on. And we can also contact the Jewish community in our area, and we can say, you know, we, the Christian churches of this area, we support Israel and stand with Israel. And we want to make our voice heard and actually come up with ways to implement changes and influence so that our government behaves in a way that reflects our values. Now, what do we have the advantage of? I know they've got a lot of numbers, but mostly when you talk about, let's say, support for Israel in general, from 40 or 50 and up, you have about an 80 percentile support rate for Israel. And then from like 30 down age group, you have about a 50% support for the Arab cause and are opposed to Israel. Now, what's awesome is that, like Reagan said, we're not going to use our age and wisdom against them, but we can. We know how, like they know how to follow, they think TikTok is actual news and stuff like that. Like they follow that and they think, oh, that's actually real. And they don't know how to distinguish between, they don't know where to even get good information. So now we should be able to be a little bit ahead of them on that, you know, just using age and wisdom. And then we also know how to write congressmen and senators. And we can, if we get together on this and we start saying, Congress, we're seeing that the enemies of the United States, which are also the enemies of Israel, this is their strategy. And we think that you in government are responsible for X, Y, and Z. So let's take, for example, the college campuses. We've seen how the massacre happened on October 7th. It was so bad, Israel on October 8th was still just getting a handle on what was going on inside of Israel. There was not any invasion. There wasn't any going into Gaza or whatever. There was just fighting to just try and stabilize the situation in Israel. And already the second day on October 8th, you had major protests against Israel on college campuses, which means they were ready to roll over here, which means there's a little bit of a coordinated effort. Like, everybody on our side was all like, where in the world did that come from? They were already out in the streets protesting the very next morning. You think they are not, this isn't like a bigger picture? Of course it's a bigger picture. That their operatives are already at work among the staff and faculty in your major universities. And you know what? This is the strategy. What's the weakness of Western democracies? Time. Our vantage point for future is, oh, the election is in November. When you're a politician, my future is based on your goodwill for the next 2 years, or 4 years if I'm president, and 6 years if I'm a senator. So in other words, if I get elected in November and I'm a senator from Oregon, I don't have to worry about you for another 5 years, and then I've got to come back here and kind of do my thing to make sure that we're in line, or at least you feel like we're in line, and then you reelect me and I go back and forget about you for about 6 more years. Congress is a little bit closer to you because every 2 years they have to come back and get your goodwill. So writing into Congress and saying, hey, I am upset about this. Now, the dictatorships in the Muslim world, they're not worried about 4 years down the road. So they're putting together 20-year game plans, which is way, way beyond any politician's concern. No politician in the United States gets into office thinking, what would be great for the United States in 20 years? And what are policies that I can implement that would bring us to a good place 20 years from now? You know why? Because he wouldn't get the credit. But in the Middle East, it's like they're looking at it and they're saying, well, let's see, Israel, aside from the support of, let's say, Western Europe is iffy, but let's say primarily the United States. Without that, they wouldn't exist, and we don't want them to exist. So instead, we've already done the whole army against army. That didn't work. We've tried other, we're trying stuff all the time to eliminate Israel. That hasn't worked yet. But if we can cause, especially the United States, to remove its support of Israel, Israel won't exist. Mission accomplished. So what if it takes 20 years? So what? So they bank on our political ADD, and they play a long game, and we're playing checkers. And in the meantime, they're making moves. Well, what they're doing, and this is especially like Qatar, the country of Qatar is kind of like the, they're like the mouthpiece, they're Al Jazeera, they're the mouthpiece of Hamas and Islamic Jihad, and they're like the diplomatic face of Islamic extremism. And again, what they're doing is they're sending millions of dollars to your universities so that they can buy the people that are teaching your kids, because the people in college today, 20 years from now, are going to be your congressmen and senators. And so if they can create a hostility towards Israel in the people that are growing up now, 20 years from now, America will no longer support Israel, mission accomplished. That's the way they see it. And if we look at college campuses, they're well on their way to achieving their goal. So you know what? Your congressmen need to hear from you. And they need to know that you're concerned that these anti-American, anti-democracy, anti-Western, anti-Israel teachers of hate are, they are the professors of Middle Eastern studies in major universities. And they are the reasons we have these protests and all that. And they're, I mean, these are people that can't identify, you know, the Vice President of the United States out of a lineup. But they know what the solutions are for the Middle East, something nobody's figured out for 80 years. They're the geniuses that have figured it out. So it's not based on knowledge or a real well-thought-out opinion. They're being taught something that is dead wrong. And it's not coming from the culture of the United States. This is external being injected into the system, and it's being injected by foreign money buying influence into your universities. And Congress needs to be able to make laws that say foreign money influencing our universities is not the way to go. And the minute, I tell you the truth, the minute Congress says any university that accepts money, we're going to cut off government funding of, believe me, there will be a transformation that is so quick it will stun you to see how great a transformation and a come to Jesus moment certain universities are going to have. You want to accept Qatari money? Okay. Then we're not giving you any. Oh, okay. Hang on. Let's reevaluate the. But they've got a long-term strategy. We need to be aware of what the enemy is doing, and we need to be able to say, hey, if all it takes is for a group of us to start writing our congressmen, putting pressure on Congress, I mean, what happened? Congress did, for a very short period of time, they called in the heads of the universities to bring them in, and then they expressed how, I mean, did you guys watch that? Wasn't that astonishing? I mean, can you, it's like you really didn't know it was that bad, right? These are the heads of the top. Like everything gets worse from there on down. It's a disease. And Congress is who needs to solve the problem, and Congress needs to hear from you. So if we just sit, even if we're aware, and we're just, oh, you know, I'm aware of what's going on, I watch the news, I follow, and all that sort of thing. No, it is our Christian responsibility to be involved in certain things. And I think this is something that God, in this day and age, is calling us to do as a body of Christ. This is extremely important. This is very, very important. It's very personal, too. But there's a big war, and the war we're fighting over there is just as real as the war that's being fought over here. It's just being done in a different way. But you guys live in a land of warfare. And it's time we, the body of Christ in America, woke up to that fact, and we say, we're soldiers in that fight, each one of us. Because, you know, your congressman, if you write a letter to your congressman expressing anxiety over this, to them, that represents 1,000 other people that didn't take the time to write but have the same thoughts. You see what I'm saying? It doesn't need a lot of us. But it needs us to actually do something. And I think that it'll speak volumes also to the Jewish community that are your neighbors here and say, hey, listen, we stand with you guys. We support the state of Israel. Now, not even all Jews support the state of Israel. I realize there's a lot of opinions out there, and that's fine. But we, the body of Christ, need to change history and say, what happened in the past, we may not be able to change, but the future is ours. And the Lord is calling on us, and we recognize that what God is doing in our lifetime is from Him. And it goes right back to that story, by whose authority are you doing these? Was that from the Lord or not? And if you say that's from the Lord, you know where you need to stand. Our Christian life is not to be hidden under some jar or something. We're to go out and be a light to the community. And I believe that what God is doing in Israel is directly related to spiritual release of His revelatory power right here in Eugene, Oregon. And it'll impact the body of Christ right here in Eugene, Oregon, that we're spiritually related. And that's my exhortation. So I don't care about the denominations and the divides. There's plenty here that we can find common ground on. All right, let's open it up for some questions. Do we have a mic for people? Anybody that, yeah.
We'll do that briefly, and then those that need to leave, we want to release and stay on time. But those that can stay, Danny's willing to take some time for question and answer. So are there leaders, spiritual leaders, pastors, leaders that can come up, and if you can pray for Danny? Sure. Yeah, so.
Yeah, absolutely. Any of the leadership here at Crossfire, or if you're a guest, thank you. Oh, sorry, get behind you here. So as they're coming, just want to share one announcement with you that was asked to make. The video from today will be available on YouTube and probably will be released by tomorrow, but there'll be an announcement on Facebook. So if you're interested in following up or you want to share the information with someone, that will be available as well. So
how do you look that up?
It'd be on the mycrossfire.com.
Okay.
On the
on YouTube.
The Crossfire website. Yeah, the YouTube, I'm not really sure.
Okay.
But you could talk to any of the Crossfire staff. Yeah, you guys come on up. We want to pray for Dan. And so we're going to pray, and then if some of you need to slip out, we're going to allow you to do that, and those that would like to stay for a few moments, we're going to have some questions and answers as well. And those of you that are here, if we could just stretch our hands toward Dan, and let's just declare the blessing of God on him and in him and through him. Father, today, Lord, your word declares that wherever two or three agree on earth, Lord, we come into agreement with the heart of the Father and the ministry of the Holy Spirit right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, we just release blessing and provision. God, open doors that no man can shut, and close doors that no man can open. Father, I thank you for Dan, the things that you have called him to do. And Lord, we just speak your blessing in Jesus' name. Lord, that there would be an infilling of the Holy Spirit, a release of the Holy Spirit for this time in history, for this moment, the groups that he comes in contact with, the individuals that he comes in contact with, the organizations, Lord, we ask for divine favor and intervention upon his life. in Jesus' name. Lord, breathe on us today. Yes. Breathe on us in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, that your Spirit went with the apostles everywhere, confirming your word with signs following. God, we speak that into him right now. The confirmation of the word of God with signs and wonders following. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Glory to Jesus. Thank you.
So as you leave, I have rocks that I've picked up from the Valley of Elah. Does anybody know what happened in the Valley of Elah? It was a battle there.
David and Goliath.
Yes. And so we all here are in the midst of a battle, and I want each of these leaders to take, it's not a smooth stone, but I picked them up. Take one, put it in your pocket. Remember, you're in a battle, and you are a leader. Some of these are actually pieces of pottery that could have been a water jar from somebody many years ago. So 2,000 years ago or whatever, but these are all pieces that I've picked up from the Valley of Elah. Somebody from your ministry isn't here, but you'd like to take one for your pastor. I have a few more. So anyway, so let us all thank Danny, and we'll stay a few more minutes for some questions and answers. And there's a reminder, there's a place here if you want to give a blessing to Danny, physical blessing. And those that, those that come up, I have some shells from the Sea of Galilee. And so take these and put these in your pocket. Remember to pray for the peace of Jerusalem as you, you don't have to put anything in the basket, but I just want you to have that. And then one more thing, we are partnering with some Jewish people in our community, just starting to get together and talk about what we can do. We're actually taking what Danny said very seriously and looking at how we can partner together. And so I know that Pastor Aaron has a list, but we're also putting together a list of those people that are wanting to work together. Mm-hmm. If that is something you'd like to do, and I won't be sending it to, out to anyone other than we'll be sending you information as we know it. Also, there is a Facebook, Sharona, what's it called? Eugene United for Israel. And this was put together by a Jewish leader, and he's invited Christians to come along in this Facebook that we can work together. There'll be advertisements of upcoming programs. There's one happening, I won't be going, it's Monday night, my blood pressure can't handle it, but it will be a very anti-Israel meeting on the University of Oregon campus, and I asked, well, will there be one of a alternate persuasion, and they're not that intellectually, whatever, to do that. But if you can sit through that and listen and absorb and want to hear, and God bless you. And so anyway, there's things coming up, but the Eugene United for Israel, you can join that. They'll vet you, and just really encourage Christians to join and participate. Mm-hmm. So we are going to do questions and answers. We'd love for you to come up here. If you don't, I'll repeat your question for the video. So does anyone have a question? Well, I have a question. Then we have somebody running for elected office, and Darren Harbick, right? Yeah. So how does this strike you? Like, what questions would you want to know if people ask you questions, some people in your potential town hall meetings and stuff? What are some of the questions that you would want to have answers to? He's thinking about that. Okay, that's a tough one. But we're so excited you're here and welcome. And let's pray for Darren as in his election process. Okay, any questions, any thoughts? How do you, okay, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Question about tourism to Israel at this point. My wife's a tour guide, so she meets a lot of evangelical Christians who come on tour. Since the war, obviously, there's just been no tourism. Now, there is the beginnings of solidarity tours that are starting to be put together. Now, these are not your regular run-of-the-mill see-the-site tours. These are more for people who are interested in current events and what's going on. I mean, obviously, it includes what it can include, but it's more people who are already on board. They want to see for themselves, go to different places, like meeting families of the hostages and things like that. And it's a little bit more of a come to get to know the land now, rather than most tours. They come and they do they're a little bit more heavy on the historical aspects and the biblical and all that. And there's plenty of areas like, okay, Hamas and Gaza are down in the south. With regards to military operations, Israel has put enough military pressure to where their capabilities with regards to being a threat to communities that are further away has been greatly diminished. So rocket attacks against Tel Aviv and Jerusalem and stuff like that, they're down like 90%+. Now they can still, again, everything is about munition types, and they still try and make a statement here and there, but the threat of rocket attacks and all that sort of thing is greatly diminished from what it was at the beginning of the war. Again, the wild card with regards to planning of tours going forward is more what's going to happen up north. Now, Hezbollah has been attacking Israel consistently from the beginning of the war as a show of solidarity. So the evacuation of the north is still in place. We still have more than 80,000 Israeli refugees in Israel. So these are displaced Israelis that can't go back to their home because of rocket attacks from the north. Usually it's the range is about 5 miles. Now, Israel's Iron Dome and defense capabilities take care of a lot of things. There are certain things you can't take care of, like anti-tank missiles operate differently than ballistic missiles. So we can give very good coverage with ballistic missiles. The question is how does that resolve itself? Because many Israelis from border communities up north know that the same threat exists from Hezbollah up north. And the pressure, political pressure in Israel is, we're not going home until Hezbollah is not on the border of Israel. Because the border is here, and then they're across the street. And you have the exact same situation you had in the south. So Israelis are saying, why should I go back home if you don't deal with that? We know that Hezbollah has the same mentality as Hamas, same objectives. So the Israeli government has told the United States, you're free to try and work on some kind of diplomatic solution for this, but one way or another, we're going to make sure that Hezbollah is not on our border. Now, back in the past, we had a buffer zone, and Israel occupied the southern part of Lebanon in order to make sure Hezbollah wasn't on the border exactly the same way. And but right now, so the question is does that come to some kind of resolution that doesn't involve the army going into Lebanon and basically reoccupying the southern part of Lebanon, which wouldn't have a lot of support in the international community, but as far as Israel's concerned, after what happened on October 7th, what's your option? Israelis don't see a security option that provides for their security, that allows for people that have been indoctrinated that their sole goal in life is the destruction of the state of Israel to be right on the other side of the street. Eventually, that ideology wants to pour over the border. So what's the solution there? I don't know. Operations in Gaza are going to probably continue through the end of 2024. As far as secure, Israel has said it will maintain security control of the Gaza Strip from now on until a better solution is found. And it's basically saying, look, international community, if you have a better solution, fine. Until you give us a better solution, don't complain about us being security up, because they have proven what they want to do, and they want to do it again. And so we're there to make sure that they don't have the capability to do it again. That's the solution. We're happy for other solutions, but you want to get creative, we're open to ideas, but they better be real ideas and not just the foolishness of two states and all that other stuff. Up north, different. So with regards to tourism, right now, everybody's kind of like, well, let's see what happens in the coming months. A lot of people have not necessarily canceled, because you can cancel a little bit further down the road. And if things look like they are settling down or whatever, I would say come over. But if they're, the north is the thing to watch. That's kind of the wild card that hasn't been put on the table yet. So hopefully that answers the question.
Is there another question?
Okay. Yeah. When you say Christian community in Israel, who are you referring to?
I honestly don't have a good answer.
Okay, the body of Christ in Israel, you have Christian Arabs who can be, let's say, Catholic, Orthodox, that kind of thing. There's the evangelical Christians who are, let's say, Arab. Jewish believers in Jesus do not refer to themselves as Christians just because of the connotations, and they still identify as being Jewish. They have not left their Jewish heritage behind in order to follow Jesus. It's just Jesus is their rabbi. When you say the body of Christ in Israel, you know, there's several definitions to that. Now, as far as the more evangelical community of Israel, which is, let's say, believing Israeli Jewish people. My wife and the village we live in near Jerusalem is they're Messianic Jews, or whatever, you know, whatever the term is being used. Obviously, Israeli Messianics are very Israeli. We serve in the army. We do all the stuff that's required by the government. We're very much a part of the people that we are. So some of the leaders of ministries in Israel, like I happen to be the head of CBN Israel. I have very good friends that were combat veterans in different ministries. And when the war broke out, all of a sudden, I mean, it changed everybody's focus and everybody's schedule. And what was miraculous, and this was really, it really was of the Lord. We do everything on WhatsApp. And so we started opening up message boards, and we were able to field a whole lot of needs. Everything was emergency. And so it was kind of like, you had to have a process of being able to purchase and then secure procurement and then delivery of goods and services to all parts of the country. And there were several ministries that are operated by, you know, guys like me, and we have kind of like this military mindset. We're all veterans, we've all been through combat. And all of a sudden, each one of our ministries has different capabilities. Like my good friend Joel Goldberg, he's the head of Netiva. Netiva serves kind of the Messianic youth of Israel. All the congregations send their young people to young people's camps and, you know, summer programs and army preparation programs and, you know, equipping of young people. So they've got a lot of contact with the young people. Then Lech Lecha is for like a post-army, before you kind of get into life, discipleship training. And so they have a lot of contact with people that are maybe, let's say, 20 to 25. So young people, not necessarily settled in careers and not married and have all kinds of commitments on that end. So they had different capabilities, but they were in a place called the Baptist Village, which is owned by the Baptists, and they have a lot of space. And we put a distribution center together with them. We at CBN did a lot of funding because we're connected a lot more to, you know, fundraising capabilities in the United States, and we were able to fund a lot of the goods and services that were being purchased, and then they would make it to the Baptist Village, to their center, and then from there they had volunteers doing a lot of packing because a lot of the young people, they knew the young people, so they would bring them in, they'd do the volunteers, they'd cook meals and all stuff like that. And then they had, Lech Lecha would be a lot of distribution because they had people that had licenses and driving, and they're driving to the north and the south and getting, so it was, I mean, it was almost overnight. You had multiple organizations, and we all, like the people that I'm talking about, we all live at Yad HaShmona. We all live on the same village. And we were all too busy. We never even met or had a meeting or strategized or anything. It was just all of a sudden over WhatsApp, we put a whole apparatus together that got stuff from suppliers. And then Shmuel, who is his wife, works at another ministry called Joseph Project. And Joseph Project does, they do shipping containers that come in, and they do distribution of goods and stuff like that. So they've got trucking, and I mean, everybody was working together all of a sudden. And she would call me up, it says, okay, Yoel's team got a request for 100 mattresses for soldiers. There was a unit up, they just got thrown into this location, they don't have anything, they're just kind of sleeping in their cars or on the ground or that. I mean, it was war. I mean, you left and whatever you arrived with, and it took the army some time to kind of get its act together and get food, winter clothing, you know that stuff. And all of us, and we'd feel, because these are our kids. My daughter is married to a captain in the Navy. My other daughter is in a serious relationship with a guy who's in training to be an Air Force pilot. All of their friends, my nephew was in Gaza up till the Sunday before I flew to America. So for the several months. So you're fielding all these requests, and then it's like, oh, can CBN cover the purchase of 100 mattresses? Yeah, we'll cover the, put the bill on us. And then the guys from Netiva would send, or they would send, the supplier would send a truck and get it delivered to the Baptist Village. They would put it on a trailer, and the next morning the guys had mattresses. And it could be ventilation fans. You know, they were people that were stuck in these areas and it was hot or something like that, and just getting some airflow. Because you can't sleep at night because it's all stuffy. And just real practical, I mean, you know, it was almost like FedEx all of a sudden appeared. Like you had everything from the source, the supplier, all the way to delivery, all covered, and several ministries each doing a part with no coordination. And it just happened. And it was like a month later, I was doing security detail in our village with one of the leaders of the other ministry, and we finally had 2 hours in the middle of the night to talk over, you know, how this worked. And we were both like, just, it was neat, you know, because it was really how, I think it was wonderful to see how the body of Christ just kind of came together impromptu, without any planning or strategy. And now it's based on relationship. I knew these guys from when I was in the Army and before that, and we grew up in kids' camps, and we, it's not like we're, everybody's doing their thing, but we have an honor and appreciation for each other and love each other, and we work together where common cause is. And that's kind of what I'm kind of encouraging on this end, where there is place for common cause on stuff. It's not a turf thing.
Okay, we have time.
Great question.
We have time for one more question, and I'm going to repeat the question for the camera. So does someone have one final question? Yes, I see a hand.
Well, right now, UNRWA,
the
question is regarding UNRWA and you know, the South Africans claiming genocide accusation in the International Court of Justice in The Hague in Holland, and how that went out. Now, they did not, they didn't dismiss the charges as they should have, but they didn't legitimize or call for an immediate ceasefire or anything else. So basically there's a reasonable kind of satisfaction in Israel that South Africa was not successful in its bid to criminalize Israel's actions currently. There is still general support for the right of self-defense. Everybody understands that the invasion that happened on October 7th was way beyond just normal proportion of just, you know, terrorist activity. That Hamas is not contributing to any prospects for peace in the Middle East. Now, the problem in Gaza is currently and has been for the last 20 years ruled by a terrorist organization that has no check on its power. It uses all of the resources, all of the humanitarian aid, pipes that were brought in for sewage and water were cut up and turned into rockets. I mean, it's at the expense of all betterment of their society. The number one focus is the destruction of the state of Israel. And so all resources that they can manage, they funnel into terrorism and strategies for terrorism. All their infrastructure, the tunnels is not for the protection of people. The tunnels is for them. Now, UNRWA employees, first of all, have been involved in the massacre itself. Israel has provided intelligence on people who actively participated in the horrendous crimes that happened on October 7th. UNRWA employees paid for thanks to your tax dollars. And UNRWA, at the very least, as an organization, first of all, is controlled by Hamas in Gaza. They are also the ideological indoctrination avenue that tells the Palestinian people that one day their goal of the annihilation of Israel will be fulfilled, and that we, the international community, by supporting UNRWA, the message that we're sending to the Palestinian people is that we actually support your aspirations for the erasing of the state of Israel one day. So on one hand, the United States supports, by declaration, a two-state solution. UNRWA and the ideology of the Palestinian Authority, the ideology of Hamas, it's all the goal, the overarching goal is the erasing of the state of Israel as a Jewish homeland in the heart of the Islamic world. Because if you look at the world map and you look at where Muslims are a majority, and then if you had to hit a bullseye in the target right in the middle, it would be Israel. And so for them, as a matter of ideology, Israel's existence and Jewish, because Islam does not come from the word salam. Islam and peace are not synonyms. It's a religion of conquest and subjugation. That's their goal. It was back in history, and it is today. So for the fact that Israel, you have Jewish people who should be subjugated, that are in a place of leadership or rulership over Muslims, to them, it's like you discovering that there was no historical figure called Jesus Christ. From a matter of religious ideology, that it's as big of a doctrinal in your face, you know, or if someone discovered the body of Jesus in the tomb, oh, there was no resurrection. It would be like, oh, well, my whole religion falls apart on this thing. The existence of Israel in any part of the land of Israel, that's what it means to the average Muslim. Because to them, religion is not like to us. It's a lot more central part of their worldview. You know, you can be a Christian and, I go to church like when someone dies. Maybe Christmas or something like that. But, you know, you can be primarily a Christian in name only, and it doesn't really matter. In Islam, in the Islamic world, this situation is, this is a poke in the eye of Islam, the existence of Israel. And UNRWA is the ideological, and every time we fund UNRWA, we are saying to the Palestinians, we actually, really, we don't support a two-state solution. We support your aspirations to one day replace Israel. That's UNRWA. And that's something your congressmen need to be aware of. The support of UNRWA and UN-funded programs that are, no other refugee in the history of refugees has what the Palestinian refugees have. They've carved out for the Palestinian refugees a whole unique universe that's only for them. And so the idea that sending money and aid through UNRWA to the people, that aid primarily goes to support the military operations of Hamas. And if there's anything left over, the people get it. But Hamas gets on trucks with guns and protects those shipments and shoots at Palestinians trying to loot them. Now, their people are genuinely suffering because Hamas is in control of it. But if you were a Palestinian living in Gaza, you would be at the mercy of Hamas because they control UNRWA, and UNRWA's the place, oh yeah, we're the ones who are distributing aid. They're not distributing aid. They are the mechanism of control of the Palestinian people. That's it. So it's not, when you give money to UNRWA, it's the funding of a terrorist organization.
So there's so much more to learn, but we're going to stop here.
And we want to thank you all for coming. We definitely want to thank Danny for sharing with us. This is our time to start our education. Pastor Aaron has his Israel course. There's many other places you can sign up here as we work together as a community to build friendship with the Jewish people, to see what we can do in our own community to stand with Israel. So let's give a round of applause to our guest, and I'll turn it over.
Thank you, guys. It was a real pleasure being with you.